My name's Dick Taylor. I'm lead guitarist with the Pretty Things. And I've been a musician for goodness knows how long. I met Mick Jagger when I was 11, when I first came here to Dartford Grammar School. We started a little band quite early on. We both did share a definite passion for music and wanting to do it. And even though we probably both thought we could never actually do it as a living, we both finished doing exactly that. I think that's what we both gained from being here and, becoming friends.
If we meet again,
Mick was the fresh-faced young boy in the class. That's about all I could remember when I first met him. Because we were all meeting one another for the first time. And he always seemed quite cheerful and sporty. He used to do a lot of basketball and stuff like that. And his father being the regional gym instructor for the whole of North Kent or something. I think it was kind of pretty much drilled into him, and obviously has kept fit up until today. Everybody in the class kind of liked various forms of music, and I had another friend, Robert Beckwith, and myself, and we liked jazz and blues and rock and roll. So, and Mick liked rhythm and blues and rock, and we kind of started talking to one another, and we started bringing records in and swapping. All our musical heroes for me and Mick was certainly Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley and Jimmy Reed and all that, and Muddy Waters, all those sort of people. And also Buddy Holly. And that was another thing I remember very well, that Mick and myself and Alan Etherington, I think Robert Beckwith, all went off and saw Buddy Holly in Woolwich, at the cinema in Woolwich. And we all loved Not Fade Away, funnily enough.
I'm gonna tell you how it's gonna be.
You're gonna give your love to me.
Mick was always quite bright and lively, but without being, he wasn't the school fool or anything like that. We had other people to perform that role, and I was the quiet one, and he sort of sat about in the middle of things, I think, really, when it comes to personality. We all had a bit of a thing about luminous socks. In fact, they got banned. I think Mick had a few pairs of luminous socks and what have you. But we all tried to do our best at rebelling against the uniform, and of course it always got squashed. And I was the one who had, apparently for those days, long hair and long sideburns. And my teacher always used to come in and go, Taylor, get your hair cut before he said anything else, and every day. So, but I think we all tried to rebel against it to a certain extent, Mick included.
Now, when I was a little boy, at the age of 5...
We had the girls' school over the road, and, of course, we'd all tried desperately to chat to them. I was probably totally unsuccessful, personally, but I think Mick used to do all right, and because he lived in Dartford. I think you'd see quite a few of the girls who were at the grammar school over the road.
I'm a man.
They always used to seem to have a girlfriend of some sort. Or several. I think, really, school was kind of fun. But we always did feel like we were being sat on. And one of our teachers said that, when I met him a few years ago, he said we were the brightest class he ever had, but we were also the most vicious verbally to one another. He said we were absolutely dreadful to one another. When we first thought about playing music, I think we all had this sort of mutual desire to do it, and at the start, not much ability. But there were several of us. There was myself, Alan Etherington, Robert Beckwith, and we started coming round, chiefly to my parents' house, and sometimes to Mick's. My friend Robert and I both had our plastic mandolins, which we progressed to guitars, and plastic ukuleles rather, and we progressed to guitars and that. And Mick showed interest in singing, and we used to go around to my house and rehearse and what have you. And he was always an incredible mimic. So whatever records we had, we used to try our hardest to emulate them. And I must say, of all of us, Mick, he might have had the easiest job because he didn't have to play an instrument, but he was always really, really good at it. For some reason, apart from all the blues stuff we used to do, he had this obsession with singing La Bamba in pseudo-Spanish. God knows what he really sang about. Oh, well, that is exactly what I used to have, the 3-3-0 up there. I bought my first guitar up in from somewhere, either in Denmark Street or in Charing Cross Road.
Definitely not that.
I still got the receipt for it somewhere.
That I like. Oh, yes.
I used to work sometimes for my father, because my father was a builder, but I used to paint the signs for various, road works or what. You know, I used to just bash out a few signs for him and get paid for that, and so I saved up my money from that. Mick did a bit better on the pocket money front. Well, I think we rehearsed once or twice at Mick's house, but generally, for some reason, it always seemed to gravitate around to my house. My parents were the most tolerant of the racket.
Finally, you locked it in your attic, eh?
Oh, no, I'll keep looking on the Isle of Wight, because you'd be surprised what turns up there.
Really?
Yeah. We used to plug everything into the light socket, which was quite remarkable because we were using tiny little amplifiers I used to plug into a record player if I was playing guitar. And we had a sort of series of power points coming off from the light socket in the middle of the room, so we had wires all over the place. My dad used to sort of come in and grump, well, I've got bloody wires everywhere, or what have you. But he was very good because he'd go and sit in the front room and not complain, even though there was this terrific racket coming out of the dining room. Oh, dear, the corner, nanny, go.
To make a pretty baby on Sunday. Oh, here we are.
I used to live just along here on the left, and I went to Brampton Primary School, which is there, and I noticed the house has changed a lot, even since I last saw it. And the leaded lights have gone, and it now has a large garage on the side, which it didn't used to have, or an extension on the side. Not a blue plaque in sight, I'm afraid. The Rolling Stone started here. Our neighbours were pretty good. I think the woman next door was deaf, actually, so that always helps. My mum actually used to supply Jaffa cakes to one and all and cups of tea, and she loved it all, and she used to particularly like watching Mick sing and dance, and she'd poke her head round the door, and he didn't really know she was doing it, and she'd have a good old... She'd be sort of looking round the door, giggling at us all, performing. Mick was pretty much a performer from the word go, and my mum certainly thought he was quite pretty amazing, actually. Whenever he sang at my house, he always suddenly turned into this whole other person who was dancing around all over the place. All this stuff about, oh, Tina Turner taught him to dance. No, he was dancing right from the off and really chucking himself about. I remember Mick did a basketball match one day, and he managed to bite the end of his tongue off. And then he came round and we started rehearsing, and suddenly he had a totally different voice. I'm not sure if it ever went back, actually. Nothing has changed here. This is very... very much as it used to be. Bexar Heath and, well, this area of the suburbs were great up until you got to be about 12, and then you realised it was... there was nothing. It was deadly. Mailman. Mostly, you know, we used to do things like play with air guns in... I remember playing with an air gun in Mick's backyard, shooting through a bucket full of earth and being absolutely amazed that this air gun had so much power. Mick's house is sort of a bit posher than where I live, in a leafier suburb. Generally, there's a bit more space in Wilmington. It was very nice. I left school at 16, and I went off to Sidcup Art School, where I met this other character called Keith Richards. Mick stayed on. He stayed on through the sixth form and then went on to the London School of Economics. Mick and Keith knew one another when they were really small. I think they were at primary school together. And then they lost contact, and I went to art school with Keith, and he knew I was in the band and doing stuff, but he was apparently too shy to actually ask if he could come along to our rehearsals. One day he had the legendary meeting on Dartford Station where he met Mick again, and Mick had a Chuck Berry album or something, and they started talking again. It was after that, I think Mick said to me, is it all right if Keith comes along? And that's when Keith started coming. So it was kind of one of those things where it just needed a bit more serendipity to actually bring, you know, Mick and Keith together again. What's all about, but you know I'm here. So although I knew them both, I was kind of semi-instrumental in bringing them together again, because they then met. And the next time we had a rehearsal, they turned up, Keith turned up, you know, at my mum and dad's house, and she had another one to feed Jaffa Cakes to. Keith became an addict for the first time to Jaffa Cakes. He was addicted to Jaffa Cakes long before he was addicted to smack. Everybody knows I'm here. When we were rehearsing, we didn't seem to have any great aim in mind, because we thought, well, no one could possibly actually like this sort of music. We were just doing it just sheerly for the hell of it. It was just something we did because we were driven to do it. And the thought of not doing it would have seemed, I don't know, we just had to. We didn't really have a name for our band until we met Alexis Corner when we started going to the Ealing Club. And Alexis asked for a tape of us. So he made a tape and we decided we'd better be something. So we decided to become Little Boy Blue, who presumably was Mick, and the Blue Boys. We never did a gig as Little Boy Blue and the Blue Boys. And the very first time we played was actually as a... We played together, Mick and I, on a stage, was at the Marquee Club after Alexis Corner had sort of discovered Mick and Brian Jones and Keith and everybody.
I got a boy child coming, gonna be a rolling stone.
The Marquee Club was the very first gig that the Rolling Stones ever did. And by that time, we'd become the Rolling Stones because basically Brian Jones had pulled us into his band.
Are you one of the original members?
Yes, one of the original members.
What were you doing before you joined?
Well, just sort of bumming around waiting for something to happen, really. You know, I had quite a few jobs and I was trying to get a band going, but it was unsuccessful until I met up with Mick and Keith.
And then I got invited to play the bass because they decided I could probably play bass if I tried. And I did, and I could. So that's when I started playing bass.
I was quite scared, actually, to do the first gig in the Marquee. I must admit to being slightly terrified, which is probably the only time I've ever had real stage fright in my life. I got it all over with.
We did Rolling Stone Blues, which is a bit obvious that that's where the name came from. We had a reasonably large repertoire of these blues things. The first gig, I think, was a bit confusing for some people because we weren't quite the blues which they'd probably come to listen to, but we did all right. We survived. The cleaner was particularly dismissive of us, apparently. Apparently he said to someone after we'd appeared there, "They'll never get anywhere." So there you go. The idea of writing songs was a bit beyond us at that time. I don't think anybody sort of thought too much about doing other material rather than blues and rhythm and blues covers. That was what we were for. You know, that's what we wanted to do desperately, to play really good rhythm and blues. And we started rehearsing in Soho.
We rehearsed in the summer every week above the Bricklayer's Arms. Ian Stewart was playing piano at that time with the Stones, and he used to turn up with his bicycle and his pork pie and put his feet up, and Mick had come off out from the London School of Economics, and I'd travel up on the train, and we'd have a rehearsal once or twice a week up there. Wednesdays, I believe. Yeah, it was great fun, generally. And we got proper-sized amplifiers. We got bigger amplifiers because Brian had started dipping into the till at the civil service stores. So the amplifiers got a little larger. We used to do it from late afternoon till halfway through the evening, when I think I had to catch my train and everybody went off to their various hovels. And of course Keith used to come up by train with me, I think, first of all, and then he was living in Edith Grove. Keith and Brian and Mick lived in 102 Edith Grove, and which I visited a few times and was appalled at the condition of it, having been used to suburban bliss and cleanliness. And I was amazed at how grotty it was. And there it is, 102. They always used to have visitors around, like Long John Baldry and who have you. I doubt if Mick's mother ever went there, because I'm sure she'd have probably carried him off home and forced him, put him in a bath for a few days or something. Our lifestyle was, pretty sort of near the bone, really. Didn't have much at all. Everybody was pretty broke, quite honestly. I think Brian had a job in the civil service stores, and the rest of us, we just got whatever we could lay our hands on, you know, working during the holidays and what have you. We were all really passionate about playing music, but I think that actually making a living out of doing it, was something we thought was something for other people. And it only, like, once, I don't know, it just started to dawn on us that maybe we could actually do something. It's funny, because when we were rehearsing, I remember a guy came in and he said, "My name's David Norris, artist representative of Cockfosters. And I think you lot, playing your country and Western, could do really well on the in American bases." And we politely took his card, and as soon as he left, he became a sort of icon for us. We thought, one, at least we've avoided being managed by David Norris of Cockfosters. Sorry, David Norris of Cockfosters, if you're still around. I think none of us had any idea of image at that time. I was going off to art school, so I suppose I was getting a bit shaggy around the edges and sort of wearing denims and tweed jacket or something. I remember wearing them. Mick was a bit more sort of preppy, I think, and Keith always used to wear a denim jacket and a purple shirt.
Yes, I remember being called dirty hippies by Paul McCartney one time. We were driving along and we were going to a party at his brother's house, and we were in our scruffy Zodiac and he was in his posh Rolls Royce, and he leant out the window and went, "Bloody scruffy hippies," to us.
I left for Stones because there's a couple of reasons. One of them was I really actually wanted to play guitar rather than bass, because it's just what I always wanted to do. And I was also trying to get into the Royal College of Art. And in actual fact, I didn't get in there. I went to the Central School of Art. I think Mick was quite disappointed that I left, and I think that I know that Brian really wanted me to stay. But I just thought, no, I want to do something else now. I started The Pretty Things with Phil May, and we started doing so many gigs that we just all left whatever we were doing. He left Sid Cup School and I left the Central School. And we've been doing it ever since. I think Mick was successful because he was going to be. Because he, even in today's, I think is much harder for people to become big. But I think Mick certainly had the stamp of a star right from the word go.
So how's about we have a nice record now by what is definitely one of the top groups. In fact, it was voted the top group in the rhythm and blues section this year, 1967. Can no other than the one and only the Rolling Stones, and here they come right now.
And we used to bump into one another on the road quite often, and I remember Mick and Keith came and played with us in Manchester. Mick came and sang with us in Manchester in a little club. We were playing in a little club, and they were playing Bellevue, and the next week we were playing in Bellevue, so we were kind of around the same scene at that time. We'd go and see them, or they'd come and see us a couple of times. The thing about leaving the Stones is it's like asking someone, do they regret putting the wrong number on their lottery card? But I don't think I did put the wrong number in, quite honestly, because I've enjoyed everything I've done, and I wouldn't be who I was, who I am now, if I'd have been with the Stones. I wouldn't be who I was, and, you know, the Stones wouldn't be actually who they were. It's just the way things are, and I've got absolutely no regrets. I think the Pretty Things are still touring, and I think the Rolling Stones are still touring, because it's actually a very enjoyable thing to do. And I'm quite sure we'll do it until we're no longer capable of it. And I think the same thing applies to the Stones, you know, that, you know, if you're a doctor, you don't stop when you're 50 or what have you, or 60. All right, so maybe 65's pushing it. But we, you know, I don't see any real reason to stop. Musicians, you know, classical musicians and jazz musicians keep going. Why shouldn't rock and roll musicians keep going? Don't ever see and shore, just to find that you had left me. You were a special one. If I hadn't have been friends with Mick, I almost certainly wouldn't have done music throughout my life. And I think the same thing maybe applies to him. I think that we were, just for a critical period in our life, we were both very pivotal on one another. And I hope, anyway, I think so. And, you know, I'm really pleased it happened. And I'm sure, I guess he must be pleased that he's done what he's done, because he couldn't have been much more successful.
Knocked on every window, looked on every